Don't worry about a thing. Just pull the trigger, son. It's going to be a little, you know, like, you don't know whether you should or you shouldn't, but you know that the pressure's on and you better do it. Okay? And you pick up the gun and then you point it.
No.
All right? Okay?
There it comes. Free feet. Right now.
This is so ridiculous. This is scary.
When I say action, you start the dialogue. Don't matter.
Fuck it, Holmes. La primera vez!
Weeks after I got off the set, I got shot. I was blind instantly. I got shot in the face, in the neck, the arm, my chest, my head. It's kind of ridiculous being a victim of a drive-by shooting when I just done an act for a drive-by, you know? I didn't even get to see the movie. If God's here with me and he wants me to see again, then I know I'll be able to see again. You know, I just have faith in myself. But if I don't get to see again, then oh well, you know? Life goes on.
Joy is one of the gang members who acted in American Me, a movie I directed about Mexican-American gangs. What happened to Joy is typical of gang life in East Los Angeles. I grew up in this neighborhood. Gangs were active when I was a kid, but today the violence is much worse. Last year, there were over 800 gang-related murders in Los Angeles County alone. This is a documentary about what we learned from the gang members who helped us make American Me on the streets of East LA and in the prisons of California.
Uno, dos, tres, cuatro.
No, mami, nos tenemos que ir, que tenemos una fiesta que hacer. Sí, mami. No, yo tengo que ir con los... por algo así tan rico. No esperen más, nada más brinquen en el piso. Yo lo voy a patear como un costumbre, chica, y sé cómo lo quieres y cómo lo necesitas. Duro y suave, rápido, con salsa.
The name of the gang right here in the project is Big Hazard. We expand to the other side of White Side, to the roller coasters, towards Lincoln Park. And that's our area. This is all Hazard. Grande, and it's been here for since the project's ever been built.
The name of our gang is MC4s. Like you can see right there, it's MC Forceros. This is the heart of our neighborhood, Michigan Avenue, MC4s. As you can see right here, we had a mural, but the cops came and crossed the side.
We are what you could say a big family, Big Hazard, you know? And if anything happens to one of our homeboys, we react by going into it. What happened? Who did it? And we will look for revenge.
Another neighborhood comes down to our neighborhood and crosses out. That's where the trouble starts, you know? We say, we get mad and we just say, fuck them, you know, let's go to their neighborhood, we see one of them, let's kill them, you know, we don't care.
Not everyone would choose to make a movie in the midst of these gangs, but I wanted the story to be realistic. We began shooting in the Boyle Heights section of East LA.
Blow that window.
And now we've all made movies. The only difference between this movie and other movies is that we're stuck in between a war zone. We're right in the cusp of like three different groups of kids. And what Anna's afraid of, and rightfully so, is that there are so many Hazard kids here that she's afraid that it's going to cause a confrontation.
Don't start giving men the power, because then they believe in taking over.
My biggest concern was safety. By bringing in hundreds of people that are normally not here, it'd be very easy for someone to drive by and fire a shot.
Checking it out, and you can be going through your stacks of 45s, making sure you have the right ones, you know, for later in the party. Right? Okay? Just to give you some business.
This is all I do right now.
This is all you're going to do right now, just so we establish.
There was no way we could film in these neighborhoods without the cooperation of rival gangs. After weeks of negotiation, they agreed to a truce. And many became actors in the movie.
Acting like it don't hurt, you know what I mean? But it hurts. And you're watching it. And you're sitting there going, yes, Iris. Okay?
And action!
La primera lives, that's it. Lives through us. It gives to us. It is us.
It's more than that's all we got.
It's all we've ever had.
When I first heard that other gangs were gonna be up here, I was feeling like, are we gonna fight in the thing, or we're gonna film? But they're sitting with us and eating with us. We know that they're there, and they know that we're here. We're taking it as professionally right now, and we're sitting at the same table. They're just right there.
They're here together. They're working from 5 o'clock in the evening to 5 o'clock in the morning. It's real stressful. It's real heavy. They become sleepy, irritated, and. But yet, it has continued, and this is her second day.
Everybody came but one.
Ana Lizaraga. She's a former gang member who now works to keep kids out of gangs. She's lost several family members to gang violence.
How many have you got from Hazard?
Her job was keeping peace on the set.
We have hired the kid that might just have been out of jail for 3 days and needed a job. We hired the kid that was pulling out of a game, but didn't have the tools to pull out of the game. So they have a different experience. They're real excited making this movie, because each one of them had a role in a part in it.
It's great. It's great.
It's been tiring, actually.
Yeah. Tiring.
I have a headache right now.
Say
that.
Being here till 5 o'clock in the morning.
This is my first time on a scene, and I didn't know it takes so long just to film a little piece of scene. And it's just real weird, because this is all my life. This is reality to me. And right here, they put it on film. It's like they're getting little parts here and there. But in my neighborhood, this is all reality. All these cars and all these. The way we're dressed, this is my original dress. That's how I really dress like this.
All right. Neto up there.
Snoop. Some of the kids also help decorate the sets.
Let's see if you can get a nice stacked writing coming down. H A Z.
Old writing.
A R D. Yeah.
Like real old writing.
Yeah, it's a little bit what Payaso is doing. Yeah. Payaso. He made me a deal. If I put his name somewhere prominent, he'd paint for me.
They're the art department. That's me.
Before you go out your door, you pray. God, I hope I don't get shot today. I mean, it's already in your conscience before you walk out your door.
If you're in a gang, you're not living life. Because wherever you go, you gotta be looking over your shoulder. Even in your own neighborhood, in your own territory, you gotta just make sure, just to be sure, nobody's there.
Well, I was coming home from the movie set. They already called it cut, and they started shooting at me. They got shot in the shoulder, my bones. It's all, right now it's all sore and everything, but it's starting to heal better now. But it's just something that, you know, it's LA, you know, just living in East LA. Things happen.
Action!
The gang members we worked with have a lot in common with the characters in American Me. The film follows the life of Santana. Santana's gang was his family.
Get the spark plug.
One night, Santana and his gang decide to test their machismo.
Don't move!
No, 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 man, go!
They get busted.
Turn your head to the left.
sentence in juvenile hall turns into 18 years in prison. Santana becomes the leader of one of the most ruthless and powerful gangs in prison history. Any one of these kids could turn out to be a Santana. Like him, they want to make a mark on the world. They're in search of identity, a sense of belonging.
To write it down on walls is an important thing for us gangs, so we could get known to other gangs. It's like advertising our own gang. When I see other gangs graffiti in my neighborhood, we feel mad because they ain't supposed to come in and disrespect our neighborhood. If we see them, we're gonna do something. We got something to shoot them with, they're gonna get shot at. We're really fighting about neighborhoods disrespecting other neighborhoods. They come over here, start shooting at us, but there's sometimes that they're too scared that they don't want to get off the cars or nothing. They just shoot the stupid way and hit innocent people. Oh, this is the spot where they killed one of my homeboys, Tico. His name was Javier Gonzalez. He was shot 3 times by a 45 caliber gun. He passed away on April 8, 1990. It makes me angry because he was the one that started our neighborhood, MC4s. And you know, they just came down. They had to call him out from his house. The car was waiting. And as soon as he got to the spot, they just came and they shot him. He was just like a brother to me, you know, because I never had brothers. And he used to care for me a lot. We used to care for each other. He never let me down in any other way, not even to all the homeboys. He wasn't scared of nothing. No matter who it was or what it was, he was always down for the neighborhood.
Grow up, you know, like brothers and sisters, and a unity. People don't understand that, but Hazard is one big family, that's all.
Come here, give me your hand. You know what, Ishii? We got our own clique, strong clique.
The scene of Mundo being inducted into the gang is really the acceptance, the rite of passage.
Our clique, our barrio, our families, that's all we got, Ishii.
The tattooing of the hand is a symbol of this whole feeling of camaraderie. They usually feel that they're outside of society and they need to feel like they're part of something, so they get involved with gangs.
I was in, I got out, and I went back in. You know, when I got out, it was just, I said to myself, damn, why did I even get out? Because I was out and I was still claiming my neighborhood. I was still looking for trouble. Everybody that came, where you from? I said, it's that MC4's gang.
There ain't no way out of Hazard. You get married, 25 kids, 5-6 houses, you're still gonna be from Hazard, you know what I mean?
I remember when we were just a couple of mocosos, causing trouble all the time and getting caught with revolvosos. But it was fun and we had so many good times. Me and you, we put our troubles behind. It was the two of us sticking it day and night, looking forward to the chance that we would get in a fight. Toe-to-toe street boxing, putazos cada día. Then we met up with some vatos that belong to a pandilla. They hit us up, where you from? I said, nowhere, man. They replied real quick and said, get jumped into our gang. Nosotros controlamos aquí, chavalas. We heard that you were tough, but sabes que we call the balas. I looked at my carnal, my homie, my dog. Before I had a chance, the gangsters hit him with the log. Ran up to homeboy and I gave him a putazo. Busted him in the grip, but todavía no hizo caso. They jumped me from behind, I tried to hold my ground. Before I knew it, man, my bitchy body went down. In the days, de verdad no me recuerdo. All I could remember was my homie sufriendo. It only lasted about a minute or two, but to me, it seemed like it would never be through. After they rushed us, they came and shook our vices. Now they respect us, before they despised us. We're in a gang now, pues y modo. Me and my homie became two down cholos. I remember you, homie. I remember you, homie. Yes, I remembered you like if it was yesterday.
I'm always gonna love this neighborhood. And I'm always gonna be proud to say I represent Hazard. And I knew that by me loving my neighborhood so much, I was gonna end up dying for it.
It's a good thing that I'm still alive right now, bro. You know, I seen people get killed right here in front of me. I seen it happen, you know, with my eyes.
Then all of a sudden, we seen another gang. They were driving up slower. Everybody hit the floor. The shotgun rang. It was bang, bang, bang. I let out a rope because tenía dolor. I seen my homeboy dying, man. I was crying. Holding him tight because I was trying to keep him alive. So the Lord wouldn't take him. His heart stopped beating. So I started to shake him. I said, please, don't die, mi carnal. If you do, then everybody van a pagar. He responded gently, gently as a dove. He said, take care of my heifer because it's her that I love. Man, I went crazy. What would you do if you see a titus homie die in front of you? I remember you, homie. I remember you, homie. I said, I remember you like if it was yesterday. Yes, I do. Yeah, I remember.
The girls are no different from the guys. They're just the same.
Even the
they're
little
just
girls.
Alike. The other day, my sister went to an interview, and these gangster girls, you know, they were veteranas, and they threw their sign, and these three little girls are only 14 and 15. They wanted to be bad too, and they threw their signs, and they followed them. They were gonna kill them in the car. You know, they're like, yeah,
they're trying to run them over. If you're not from the neighborhood, you claim it. Hey, you have to take what comes to you.
Yeah,
you have to take what comes.
And
then
we're scared.
Innocent bystanders.
We're headed into probably the hardest point of the shoot. We now know that in the last week, there have been three deaths in the two-block radius in which we're working, none connected with us. We've been very, very fortunate, and we want to just intensify that good luck that we've had by taking some more precautions.
Another parking lot. You know what?
Worst case scenario would be a drive-by shooting. Some of the things we look for, are vehicles that are continually going by a couple, three times. The type of vehicle, you know, a low rider. And just keeping your eyes open. Just staying on top of them and not letting them get the drop on you.
Everybody has guns in those gangs now. They really like it. They like that power, and they like the feeling of firing randomly into people who have nothing to do with anything. And it becomes a high. It's something that's not gonna go away right away.
Homicide on the murder scene. Another frustrated gang-related senseless claim. Victim, a young product of the project system. The sad fact is nobody's gonna miss him. True, if you may stand in disbelief, but the majority will side up the youth because of the fact he was a menace to society and gang violence was his first priority. So now you take a look to see where this all got him. Someone quicker with the trigger, straight cold shot him. Dead in a puddle of blood he lay. Another typical day in the streets of L.A. Homicide on the murder scene. Homicide on the murder scene.
Suspect
number one
suspect is a male, black, brown,
6 feet
170, wearing dark clothing.
It goes from gang members involved in family disputes all the way up to, like last night, we had another senseless gang murder, just gang on gang type murder. And funny part about it, we know there's going to be retaliations over that one too. Just it's a continuing problem. And if you give me an answer how to cure it, I'd be welcome to hear it.
I heard like shots. So when I heard the car behind me, I knew it was a drive-by. I turned this way. When I turned this way, that's when he shot me in the back. One of the bullets came out of right here. Right here. And the other bullet, it's to my arm right here. Another bullet. It hurt it a lot. I couldn't breathe. I was scared. I wasn't afraid to die because I knew I was already dead. That's what I told myself, I'm dead. You know, why be afraid? I was afraid of where I was gonna go from that point.
Another one of my homeboys got shot. His name is Jose, they call him Wino. He got shot in the neck, now he's paralyzed.
Trying to see, esperar one of the homeboys to get
shot. He's back in the neighborhood, he came to take a look at it. We're happy.
Martin!
Si.
Ven!
Mueve los pantalones. Ayúdame a levantarme, ya me debo de aquello.
Sometimes I feel like, you know, they get tired of me, you know, the people get tired of me. Give me this and give me that, and do this and do that, and, you know. They were my enemies. We were doing some bad things to them, you know. We killed some lady from there, and, but that's a part, you know, how I get shot. And they came close to us. They put the gun in me, and I was trying to fight with them. And they start shooting me. But that was when he came in my neck, and I fell down, and that's it. And you know. And he just gave me, I don't know how many times he shoot me right there. And the floor, I think, was 3 or 2. I don't know, because I can't remember nothing, you know. Everything is different now. I was starting to get a boxer. I was doing fine, but they stopped me. By the gangs. I'm not angry.
Where can I go?
Right now, I just want to go to school, you know, and do my business. And that's it, go to school and go to school, you know?
Yep.
Nah. When I was first starting, to me, it was a joke. It was just a game. But then in time, I realized that it wasn't a game. It was war. Just like the war that just happened, you know, it's just fighting each other. And it's really stupid because we ain't fighting for nothing that we own. The neighborhoods is not ours.
Let's pull your tricycle right over here. Come on, let's pull your tricycle right over here.
We come into this one location, and all of a sudden, who's there to greet us but a little kid, 3 years old. For whatever reasons, the parents are not around him. He's a very tough little boy. He has been on the street for a long, long time.
You sleepy? You want to be in the movie with us? You want to be in the movie with us? See what they're doing to you?
It makes you sensitive towards the fact that environment is everything. You can see it. If this child was getting exposed to a person even reading a book, he would accept it.
Don't laugh, okay? Don't laugh, Jojo. Don't laugh. Whatever you do, you're on camera, so don't laugh, okay?
He is the future gang member, because he's out on the streets and he sees it going on, and he's attracted to it.
We're a third generation Ramona Gardens family, and my only education was gang style of living. I would look at the older homeboys and I said, all right, man, that's what I'm gonna be. You know, if not, I'm gonna be better than them. I'm gonna be better than them. You know, and I achieved that status. I got some guys that are not gang members.
Jerry is a respected veteran of the ℌ𦘦𝘦 gang. His help was crucial when we filmed in ℌ𦘦𦘦 territory.
A lot of my friends are dead now. You know, I'm one of the ones that's still alive. I'm 32 years old. I'm a rare thing here, you know. When you're older than 30 years old here, you know, you're a role model, whether it's positive or negative. This is Gil Espinoza. He's from MC4s. I worked in his neighborhood. They gave me a lot of respect down there, and I expect it from my homeboys here. You may want to interview you. You can cooperate with him if you want. One of my ways of getting out of Ramona Gardens was through being in the gang, the crime, the whole bit that goes with it. Prison was a thing that I wanted to go to. It was in college. You know, I didn't want to go to Stanford or USC or something. I wanted to go to San Quentin, you know. I looked forward to that, you know. And I didn't get to San Quentin, but I got a Folsom, which I think is maybe a step higher even, you know.
These kids go from being streetwise gang members into prison. And when they get out, then they think they can start their lives. They don't see alternatives to the gang life, because that's what's happening all around them. What's happening out there is drugs.
He's a professional smoker, too.
With no skills and jobs hard to come by, kids start dealing to make a buck. Gangs control most of what happens.
Pull his head back.
Okay.
That's when he says,
you lie, right?
Don't you know who we are, man?
Yeah. You know who we are?
Yeah, I know who you are.
Before you say that, before you do that, it'll be a situation where you got him like this, you got him like this, and you say the line.
In the stash house scene, members of the gang sort out and cut the different drugs that they're dealing.
The balloon's hanging like that. You always go like this to make sure that it gets down to the bottom, and then, of course, the spoons. I need an eighth of a spoon and a tablespoon.
So, Anna, how do you know all this?
I watched a lot of people.
She reads a lot of books, huh?
No, I watched my parents do it.
Check out the
some more stuff over here, huh? You'll be cutting.
Every kid in this scene is a gang member. A lot of them have been involved with drugs, and you could tell by the way they work the equipment.
And as he cuts it, you start to see his face materialize inside the mirror.
Step on again, Holmes. Not too much. JD wants a good count. It's gotta be right. Our name's going out behind this.
It makes me nervous looking at all this shit and not being able just to chip a little tease, brother.
Business, team man. Then we'll think about taking a little bit off the top.
Capone was a godsend. He was born and raised in Hazard and has lived this life totally.
You struggle here and you gotta find a way of making money, and you know, robbing got old and stealing got old and drugs seem to be easier to make money. And my easiest way was at the time was pushing PCP. I was liking it and I was living the fast lane till I hit the wrong car and sold to the wrong person. And that's what started my career in institutions. Juvenile hall and then juvenile camps and then youth authority, then state prison, federal prison, back to state prison.
You guys ready?
The intent of the scene is to show what are some of the prices that one has to pay when they play the game.
Drop the gun! Now! Back up against the wall.
Down on your knees, put your hands behind your backs.
Now! You know who we are?
Yeah, I know who you are. Now breathe. Deep! Breathe.
Cut!
You all right? You all right? Yeah. All right. Look, take him outside. Come on, lean him up.
You looked up to these guys that sell dope on the corner. You look up to these guys that can ride a Mercedes or a BMW in the community. You see all the cash that's rolling around, and the little youngsters that are looking up to him are wondering, well, when am I going to be up there? Not knowing that when they get out there, they're going to go to 20, 10 years, and it's going to break a woman's heart. It's going to break your parents' heart.
We lost one of the youngsters the day before yesterday, I guess. They found $50,000 cash and a kilo of cocaine and guns and ammunition in his house.
They found some rock cocaine and started saying whose was it and stuff. And that was it.
You allow them an experience in hopes that they will end up being able to use it in some way. And
let's have a rehearsal now. Meet the actors.
It's just fruitless because of the usage of drugs like PCP and cocaine. It gets to be really difficult to see them come out of it.
I live in a very poor neighborhood and stuff, and I always wanted good things. I'm addicted, I'm addicted to money. I gotta have money all the time. The lifestyle is good, but people are jealous because they ain't driving what you got, and they ain't wearing what you got. And people got to go to work. And me, I don't have to go to work, I get up and I do what I want. And I sleep as long as I want.
Okay, you ready?
Okay, Ramundo.
Ana Lizarraga, our gang negotiator, also played a part in the film.
You gotta go. Gotta go.
Okay.
And focus back after she goes out.
Right.
In one of the most stirring scenes, she finds her grandson overdosed on the bathroom floor.
Fine, then I'll just open it back up. Neto? Mama! 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 Call an ambulance! Get me to come on!
It was very, very true to her and very real. She's lived that moment.
Cut!
I dealt a lot with ODs or kids that want to die, or kids that had died. And whether it's an OD or it's a drive-by shooting or whatever suicide it is, you know, kids are still taking their lives away. They're playing with dynamite and they don't even recognize.
Do I think it's worth it? No, no, but you know, when you get started, it's like, you know, you just can't stop till, I guess, till they put you away. You know, till they really, really put you away. They gave me 4 years. 4 years. Freedom taken away, you know. Wake up 6 o'clock. Go to breakfast and program day by day. Being at the top, I was always used to, but I could still be at the top when I get out, but I just got to do it legally. I don't want to come back and go through the same routine over and over, you know, and next time it'll be more time that I get if I get caught.
Folsom Prison near Sacramento is where a lot of the gang kids wind up. Many spend their entire adult lives behind these walls.
That's how it goes with me. Well, I'm not a rebel, but I'm known to rebel against ignorance, keeping my brothers in jail or hell, whichever one you are living in, friend. And if you think it's hell, you never been in the pen. Homeboys is doing time waiting on an appeal. Attitudes get adjusted because we fight with steel. Human lives being took, characters are destroyed. And when the gates rack, it's not funny no more. And it's hard to stay together in a two-man cell. To make a long story short, the pen is hell. To me and every brother that I know in the pen is running one marathon with a dreadful end. To reach the dark shadow at the India Road is a chance you'll take with the word parole. Another man trying to tell you how to live your life, how to raise your kids and treat your wife. Beat the clock, but you won't beat time, and you will never chase the world out of here, my rhyme. Cause every episode of writing is coming fresh from here, just like the book of life is what the devil fears. By trade, I run the mic with the best of skills, dropping knowledge on paper with a pen at will. I'm not wise as now, but I'm wise enough to understand ain't nothing changed and the world is rough.
Prison's nice, ain't it? Hey, Godfather, what's going on? There's some gangsters right here. There's some real gangsters. Excuse me, fella. Excuse me. Coming through.
I've probably seen a little bit of everything in here. I've seen from sodomy to murder to an inmate hanging to an inmate jumping off the fifth tier because he had a deer John later. Anything that a human being is capable of doing to another human being, I've probably seen it a time or two in here.
Don't cling him.
Folsom Prison is a maximum security prison. One third of everybody here is doing some kind of a life sentence. About one third of everybody we've got here is some kind of sex offender. So having all you civilians, 88 civilians, coming in, it's taking a chance. It's taking a big chance.
What point you say, go that way. Or you'll say, go up there. When you go up that way, you go over there and you wait for me, or you wait for the white guy.
We actually convinced the prison to let us use real inmates as extras in many of the scenes.
We need you guys to be doing the real thing and not be paying any attention to us. Some of you facing different directions. We're not going to just shoot this way. We're going to move around, inside, coming around, different angles.
I don't know what you guys do, you know. It happens, but when it happens, you do it.
I'm moving these guys out on the yard right here, kind of facing each other, and then do some exercises in this area. I want.
Well, I'm the leader. Leader ain't got exercise.
Leader ain't got exercise. Leader just right. Watching.
There were only 7 actors on the main yard when we were filming there. All the rest of the hundreds of men out there were real inmates of Folsom.
As far as I know, it's the first time thing ever to happen here, where they have allowed people from the outside to come in and dress as convicts. It made a lot of stress on all the gunners when the situation was occurring. When they first came in, it was no big deal. I seen a green vest. I knew right away that these people must be in the movie, and I was thinking maybe they were going to have them keep those vests on for mingling with the inmate population. When they came off immediately, I lost who they were. I was concerned about if something was to happen and I have to fire my warning shot, would I be firing at an inmate or would I be firing at an actor?
One day while we were filming out in the main yard, the alarm sounded and some guards came running by. A moment later, an inmate was rushed by on a gurney. We had no idea what happened, but we imagined it had been some kind of assault or stabbing.
He got hit over the head with a weight pile, like a round weight or the dumbbell. But it happens all the time, it's just because racial stuff, you know what I mean? Somebody disrespects someone else, and they just start, getting off on each other.
This is a different world from out there. It's dangerous in here. It's dangerous. It's real dangerous in here. Because there's people in here that ain't got nothing better to do but be dangerous.
When you come here, your life is don't mean a dime anymore. You got to have eyes everywhere. Because anytime, any moment, somebody can take your life for anything.
All these weapons are made to stab somebody or to have somebody stabbed. Some of the weapons that are confiscated here at Folsom Prison. For example, this weapon here was used on our main yard. You could still see the blood on it. And this was actual called hit from one of the gang members. That means an inmate who we call a shot caller asked an inmate or told an inmate to stab somebody. A lot of our aluminum pieces are found inside our dining room area. They're cut from there. We have plastic weapons that are utilized here. Plastic spoons, styrofoam cups, combs, and Ziploc bags. They're melted down, and then they're sharpened. Inmates are very ingenious. For example, here's a weapon that was found in our facility just recently. As you can see, that's a pretty effective weapon.
Gangs in prison are much more intense and ruthless than gangs on the streets. They control many aspects of prison life, including who lives and who dies.
You got Crips, you got Red Rags, you got BGF, you got Aryan Brotherhood, you got Skinheads, you got Southern Mafias, you got the Northern Enemies. It's an identity thing.
When they first started, gangs were formed to protect their own against the other races. That was one of the reasons. Another main reason was when you first came into the institutions, they were there to help you out, to get you started.
The main thing once you get to prison that you realize is survival. And I'm talking about all kinds of survival. I'm not talking about survival, just your life. I'm talking about your manhood and a whole lot of other things. So you click up to stay a man.
If a gang member is asked to stab somebody, he's expected to do it. If he refuses, he's often chosen as the next victim. That's what happens in the scene.
To shank somebody here, would they actually go for the heart or would they try to get underneath the solar plexus?
To tell you the truth, they'd go for the one-shot kill.
I once got caught up in a situation like that where an order was given to me to stab another inmate. That's what happened when they asked me to do this. He straight out let me know, you don't have to do it. Then again, I already knew, since the time I've been around, I already knew that if I didn't do it, chances are down the line, it was gonna catch up to me. He used to be my neighbor in the tier, and so we used to talk to each other and that, and I got him all buddy-buddy talking next to me. So, I get him next to a bar where we're working out. And while he's doing his bar work, I just so happen to stab him towards around this area.
Open your eyes, Otto.
Everybody down!
The only means to respect in here is aggression. I mean, if you can't kick ass, if you can't back a person up off your line, you're going to get taxed. And usually the taxation be getting ran up in. Taxation used to be becoming a victim of your environment.
When are we going to do the rape scene?
The rape scene is probably going to be done at the end of the week.
We got us a customer over here.
For a lot of the people here, they're never getting out. This is their home for the rest of their lives. And whatever possibilities they had are over. It's gone. And if this movie can keep some young kid or some young kids from wasting the chance, the one chance that they have at life, then this movie and the risk that we've taken will have been worth it.
I never thought I was gonna end up in prison. I mean, I'm out there 25 years, and all of a sudden I get 15 in life. I say, whoa, you know? It's no game. This is not a game. It's something that, even now, every day, tell you the truth, every day, I sit back in my cell, lay down in my bunk, and I think a lot.
In life without. That's the kind of loser I'm talking about. Got charged with murder in the first degree, cause he shot another man doing a robbery. His attitude was bad, no remorse was felt, so they gave him the shaft and tried him as an adult. And now his future is gone because he chose to rob when all he had to do was go and get his punk ass a job. So take notes if you will, this ain't no ordinary rhyme. It's a message, my friends, only losers do time.
From generation to generation, we've been taught, oh, going to jail is fun. You come out, you come as a hero. Our kids don't have no heroes. There's no Latino heroes in East LA.
When I was growing up here, my dad was always in and out of prison. When I needed somebody to play ball with, somebody to play catch with, I always had older homeboys like Mundo, Flappers, Chancla, Steve DeFrancis, and them. They were around, and they were there for the kids, and they'd throw the baseball with me for an hour, half hour, and even if it was 5-10 minutes. But see, they became role models in my life. I didn't look at them as gang members. I didn't look at them as a bad person. I looked at them as somebody that paid attention to me.
Frijoles?
Queremos saber si es posible tomar una parte de la película por aquí y poder entrar y tomar la foto de aquí. Yo me quedo acá afuera.
He didn't close this setup, and people are watching this. People are getting exposed to this, and this is almost. So somewhere along the line, some child is going to say, hey, if he can do it, and I look like him, why can't I do it?
Are we going to be in the movie, though?
Oh, yeah. You guys are in the movie right now.
Yeah.
You're in the movie, yeah. Look it.
Oh, my God.
I think role models are the most important thing kids can have in their lives now. What I hope I bring is an ability for them to see that it is possible to dream and hold on to those dreams.
Cut! That's it. One more time.
For me to get out of the gang is really going to be hard. Because, like I said, it's just like a family. I'm gonna have to be leaving it little by little, stay away from it. Those guys that been gang members too, I know pretty sure inside they wanna change just like me. So it's good having it, then filming it around this neighborhood. And then especially two gangs working together that don't get along. Nobody has ever done that before, you know. Working together, it amazed me.
They treated you like you were somebody, not like you were just some scum off the streets, you know, some, you know, gang member and all that. They treated you like you were somebody's. They didn't, like I was important to them, you know, like I was needed, you know.
One night near the end of our shoot, Arturo Jimenez, a Hazard gang member and one of our extras, was shot and killed by a deputy of the sheriff's department.
Smokey was a member of our gang. His name is Art Jimenez, his real name. And he was a good guy, you know, he played in a small part of American Me.
He liked it, you know, and it was his way it was an opportunity for him that he wanted to grow on.
Well, it makes me sad, bro. You know, there's a lot of sadness in my neighborhood. There's a lot of homeboys that I know that died. You know, it's really not like a big thing anymore, you know?
When I was 6 years working with gangs and I buried 26 kids, after all the funerals I've done, I'd always corner the kid who I thought was vulnerable enough to hear something from me after he's passed by the open casket of his dead homeboy. And I'd put my arm around him, he's crying, and I'd say, hey, you know, I never want to see you lying in a casket at 17. They always said one of two things, and it was eerie because it was always the same. They'd say, you got to die sometime, or they'd say, why not? If a kid cannot imagine a future for himself, then his present is not very compelling at all. And so he doesn't care whether he inflicts harm or whether he ducks to get out of harm's way.
It's a very, very ugly situation here. It's really bad.
Chaos, motherfucker, chaos!
8 months after we finished filming American Me, the streets of LA exploded after the Rodney King verdict.
I have yet to see a large contingent of National Guard.
Brand new shopping center is going to be a total loss.
You can see them racing in and out of the front of the store. There are no officers in the parking lot. The looting is taking place.
We are.
A few months after the riots, we caught up with some of our homeboys.
A robbery occurred in the neighborhood. The suspect, you know, the way I look at it, the suspect, you know, he looked like me, you know, so that's what brought me back.
What's your last two numbers?
I loved acting, you know, something you dream about, you know, that thing would never happen to you.
Okay, step on over here.
I didn't believe in myself, I guess. I didn't believe it that I could do something with it. I thought I was just being fed this, like to get good work out of me at the time, you know, but deep down, I didn't think that I could take it further, you know. I felt that, you know, once this film was over, it was gonna be over, you know, and you know, you just go back to, you know, what we were doing before, you know, but, man, I wish I would have grabbed it and ran with it, you know, but. It's me, I can't put the blame on nobody else. I gotta set a goal and go with it, you know, and just stay out of that neighborhood and, you know. It's harder and harder to do time now, you know, when you were younger, you know, hey, it wasn't nothing, you could deal with it, but now it's like, you know, it's getting old, man. I'm getting old. I mean, you know, I'm not gonna rot in these places, you know. It's either I make that move now or, you know, this is gonna be me, you know, career criminal.
In this December, one of my youngest brothers was killed. He was 17. We all knew the consequences of walking in a gang. And it's been hard though. I have shot people before and hurted a lot of other people, but it was something that I didn't care about because it was either them or us. Now that my brother passed away, I see the way my mom cries, my dad. Now I know how other families cry. And I can't no more because now I have a conscience.
This is a memory of my brother Javier.
And I learned a lot from the bad. And now I want to turn into something good. I enrolled in junior college, and I like it. This is what I want, to be doing. I'm studying law, and I want to be a probation officer. I want to give people a chance. I want to give someone a chance, because no one gave me a chance.
What's a wrong friend, sir? First of all,
this is the last time you guys talked to me. The last year, I started working for the casting director, Sally Pearl.
Oh, am I alone here? You two must be studio execs.
I learned a lot, and now I'm here doing a show at the American Renegade Theater. This is where I spend most of my time, you know.
It's an encyclopedia.
I consider them another family.
It's a billboard.
They take me, you know, they accept me for what I am, and I like that, you know.
You got a menu on your back?
Whoa.
What's your name? Nah, it's just my last name.
Whoa. Gee, that must be a painful initiation. What's that, MCF? What's that?
The gang.
What's it, like, what does that mean, like mostly Christian fellas?
Where are you going to have the
light? I'm a soldier, a bodyguard, you know. Last show, I was a furniture mover. It was called Lady on Fire, and I didn't have no lines, but I just moved myself on stage, like, just moved myself, and I had fun with it, and people loved me.
Didn't you used to work at Le Dome?
Yeah, until some big goon and ugly jacket got me fired. He looked just like you, only not as stupid.
It's fun being on stage.
Hey, funny man, I got a tip for you. You're fired. Hey, we need a new waiter.
After this show, I want to do light or stage manage. This is the way I'm educating myself little by little, you know. I said I was gonna go back to school, I did, but in a way it was like I couldn't handle it. But I tried to educate myself my own way, you know. Those gang members think that we don't have a choice, you know, other than just being out there on the streets, gang banging. We all got choices. You could do whatever you wanna do. Sometimes we think that we gotta prove things to other people. You don't have to prove nothing to other people, just to yourself, what you could do, what you could be.
There needs to be peace in our barrios. The drive-by shootings need to stop. We don't need no more dead people on the street. We need educated people. We don't need to go to more funerals. We've been to too many of them. We don't need another drug dealer in the community. We already have too many of them.
On May 14, 1992, Ana Lizárraga was murdered by members of her former gang.
Lizárraga was packing for her mother's funeral in Utah. Two masked men rushed to the driveway and opened fire. Police say she was executed. Police aren't sure why she became a target. They're looking at her work as a gang counselor. The one-time gang member was trying to get kids out of gangs.
She would help us if, like, we were her own kids. She would bend her back for us and try to help us, try to make us stay clean.
Ana showed a lot of kids that they do have a choice, that there is a life outside the projects. Her death reminds me just how far we still have to go.
The big gang problem is not going to stop overnight. It wasn't started overnight. It's not going to stop overnight. It's going to take a lot of work. Not necessarily a lot of money, but a lot of work. Because what we got to do as a society in general is we got to stop working against them. And we got to start working with them. We can't keep degrading them, trying to show them they ain't nothing in this world. And everybody has to be somebody in this world to live a good life, you know.
You know how to play, huh? You know how to play? You can learn, okay? Okay?
I think the kids in East LA, like any kids, they need hope.
You gotta practice.
The only way you get hope is by having the opportunity to see a future. And right now it looks pretty dark.
Boom, boom, pick it up. Boom, boom, pick it up. Boom, boom, pick it
we
up.
We need to commit ourselves to building a better future for them with education and jobs.
Now I lost, see?
And the kids have to choose to stop the violence and take responsibility for making that future happen.
Hey, a girl. All right.